Is it time to update OBS Studio? This might be the first time that I ever recommend taking your time updating OBS versions, despite it being a significant update to the software. I'm EposVox, the Stream Professor, and OBS Studio version 28 just released. This is a release that celebrates 10 years of open source streaming software and brings significant upgrades to the program, but it comes at a cost. Well, not a monetary cost, let me be clear. It's still 100% free to use and open source, but there's a consequence of this update. First up, we get HDR and 10-bit color support. This involved a complete rework of the color pipeline for the software, and it just cannot be understated how big of an update this is. This allows for a few things. HDR recording in HLG or PQ, if you have an HDR video source such as a next-gen game console or high-end camera and appropriate capture hardware that, you know, supports HDR. Then HDR streaming to YouTube via the HLS protocol is now supported. Again, PQ or HLG. 10-bit recording if you want to record your camera for better color grading capabilities or less color banding. That's also supported, though it's worth noting that all web video platforms except maybe Vimeo clamp your video back down to 8-bit so that Advantage only lasts until you upload the video, so it's just a boost for editing. This also allows you to tone map HDR sources to SDR directly within OBS. This is wonderful news for single PC content creators who want to play their PC games in HDR. You no longer need LUTs or anything like that for your games to make it look correct to viewers if you still want to create normal SDR content, which most of you probably will want to. For dual PC or console streamers, you can now leverage HDR capture on a decent amount of capture cards and let OBS tone map it for you instead of the capture card, which in my testing ends up looking significantly better on most capture cards. I was kind of surprised at how much better it looks. All of this HDR setup is covered in a few videos on my channel already, linked below if you want to know how to use it all. AMD's AMF encoder, for those of you with AMD graphics cards, has been updated and B-frame support added, allowing a small performance and quality increase, though B-frames is only supported on RX 6000 series GPUs. That's just an AMD limitation. I covered this update also in depth already, video linked below. In fact, speaking of links below, there is no sponsor for this video, just lots of self-promos. I have a few remaining stock of our awesome Stream Professor desk mats and pins at eposvox.gg/merch, and I just launched an entire new education YouTube channel dedicated to art resources and creative stuff like that, linked below. Mac users get big updates with native Apple Silicon support for M1 and M2 users at long last, plus support for Screen Capture Kit, which is a better way for capturing windows on the desktop and allows for much better performance using those capture methods on macOS, which is pretty wild. I know a lot of people are excited for that, as well as improvements to the Apple hardware video encoder support, so you can use hardware encoding. Those were added as well. As big as the 10-bit and HDR update was in general for the software, this update is absolutely massive for Mac users in general, and I'll hopefully have some content covering that soon. Application-specific audio capture was added to the Windows version, allowing you to just capture a specific game or program's audio on its own without the need for voice meter or virtual audio cables or anything like that. This means you can capture just your game sound without the music you have playing or your Discord voice chat or something like that if you like, and so on. The plugin for this that we covered in the past still has some extra features not yet implemented in the official build that we're seeing here, such as capturing everything except a specific audio program or something like that, but I think this is fine for most users. Nvidia RTX broadcast background removal was also added for Windows users, allowing RTX card streamers to not need to use the Nvidia Broadcast app anymore to use this feature. And RTX noise suppression filter also got support for the room echo removal filter effect that was added a while back to the software, which is pretty nice. A new cleaner default theme was added called Yami, so if you launch the update, that would be why it looks a little bit different than you might expect. You can also now automatically split recordings based on time or file size, or set up a hotkey to just split recordings whenever you want, which is awesome. Plus, OBS Websocket 5.0 is now natively integrated, allowing for programs to control OBS, such as Atom, StreamerBot, things like that, to use the new features of the new WebSockets build and things like that. There is a compatibility update to 4.9 if the program you use hasn't updated yet, so that's available as well. You're also able to use newer installations of Python for Python scripts, which helps alleviate a major pain point in all of my OBS scripts roundup videos. But as mentioned, this awesome, amazing update did come at a cost, as it also updated the UI framework to a new version of Qt, the software they used to build the UI. It was previously on Qt 5, and now they've updated it to Qt 6, which will bring some overall mostly minor benefits, but benefits behind the scenes and security updates and things like that. But in the short term, it means that any 32-bit operating system, Windows 7, Windows 8, and macOS 10 10.13 and 10.14, as well as Ubuntu 18.04, will no longer be supported. At this point, it's very difficult to run a capable recording or streaming rig with those older systems anyway, for the most part, but those users will still be able to use OBS 27 at least. They just won't be able to upgrade to newer versions moving forward. This change also breaks the UI for all current plugins. Plugin devs have been notified, and I know that a bunch of them are working on it and should be releasing updates either on this day of release or very soon thereafter, but this is the reason I would recommend holding off on actually updating if you use plugins. Check which plugins you're using, go find them on the forums or on GitHub, and see if they have been updated to have OBS 28 compatibility. If there's any that you rely heavily on that don't, you should not update yet. You should hold off, because they will just be disabled when you launch the new update, and then you won't be able to use them. So that would be a problem. You can still download the zip build of OBS 28 and run it portably with the --- portable flag on its shortcut to experiment with it if you want to try out the new features and things like that, but try to be patient and give plugin devs a bit to update. I've heard it can be a little annoying, but it's worth it. Speaking of which, I happen to know someone is taking over maintaining the OBS NDI plugin. So not right away, but soon-ish we should have news to share on that front, which I am very excited for. There's been a lot of demand for that. Also as a teaser, the wonderful PKV saw my video about upward compression for gaming content to help your gaming audio be a little bit more coherent to viewers, and built an entire upward compression plugin for OBS. It's not in OBS 28. It looks like it's slated to be added to the OBS 28.1 or .0.1 or whatever update comes next, whenever that should release, but I'm very excited for this. I've already been testing it. It rules. What are you excited for with this update? Comment down below. Join us on Discord, discord.gg/EposVox, to discuss this more in depth, and check the videos linked below for deeper dives on each of these updates and things like that. I'm your stream professor, and remember to be kind, rewind.